It's time to talk offensive line on the KSO Show as we continue to preview the 2019 Kansas State football season each week with these podcast series. This is the only Wednesday release. Every other one, DY, has been on Saturday. And this, in some ways, is the third time now we've tried to record this.
I was gonna say, it's the only one that won't be on a Saturday. Hopefully, it's the only one we have to redo three times.
Right. Now, one of them was a full pod. We poured our heart into it and then realized we had a bad mic and it didn't work. The last one, we just did, like, you know, 2 minutes into, like, 30 seconds ago. The problem, like I said on that one, though, is when you have to do the same pod multiple times, it's not that the job's that hard or it's not fun to do it. It's you start to feel like I've already said this one line three times, and they probably are tired of hearing it, but they haven't heard it yet. You know, this is their first chance at it. So
don't trick yourself.
No. So this is the KSO Show. We're talking all offensive line, part of the 2019 preview podcast series we're doing. This is, of course, presented like all our shows by Tallgrass Tap House, Bourbon and Baker, and Harry's, all three located on points here in Manhattan. Great places for you to go to when the season gets going. Another point you made, I think, at least in the last pod, DY, that we didn't release, was it's good that we have to do this one because you've learned more since the first time we recorded this, right? That's good.
Yeah, we've learned more, and we'll probably even learn a little bit more before we this airs and releases to our listeners, actually, because a practice we'll have seen, at least part of one. And you get to talk to Coach Kleiman, I think.
I believe you're correct. So, yeah, this pod should be releasing Wednesday, August 7th. On Monday of the week, you're listening to this pod. Derek and Flando were able to attend, like they said, at least part of a practice. We're not sure how much of it we got to see. I like talking in this half future tense, half past tense, you know, all this kind of thing. But the point, reason we bring this up is because if you read some stuff on the site from DY or Flando or me the last couple of days, and then something we say on this podcast flies in the face of that, that's why, and go ahead and default to what we said first. So we're going to break down the offensive line. This is the one, really, this was the one I wanted to do more than any other. A poster, it was either Willie 2007 or KSU Freak. I can't remember which one. I know asked at one point, hey, could you guys do a podcast that just breaks down the entire offensive line and really looking at that position in depth? And I thought, yeah, we should do that. But then I thought, well, if we're going to do O-line, we have to do all of them. You know, we're going to do every position to preview the season. Point is, this is the one I was looking forward to, DY, because it might be the most interesting to talk about because you have so many players on scholarship at this position.
Yeah, most players. And this is going to be a critical position moving forward. And it's one that's going to need addressed immediately after the season, too, because there are four senior starters.
Absolutely. And let's start there. First, we'll go position by – I'm just going to start by reading off every scholarship player on it, and then we'll start talking about them. As seniors, you have Evan Curl. We'll talk about him, likely backup at a lot of spots. Scott France, Adam Holtorf, Nick Kaltmeyer, Tyler Mitchell Jr., Justin Eichmann. These are all scholarship players. I'm not listing off any walk-ons right now. Sophomores, Ben Adler, Harrison Creed, Josh Rivas. Redshirt freshmen, Katori Leviston, Christian Duffy. True freshmen, Trevor Stang, Taylor Potier, and Cooper Beebe we have listed at this position. We know he's working at guard. You might see him listed as a D-tackle on some rosters here and there. DY, let's start with the starters. We know who they're going to be. I think more than any other position other than maybe go quarterback and maybe a couple spots on the D-line, like it's going to go, we're going to see, you know, the tackles are going to be Scott France and Nick Kaltmeyer. The guards are going to be Josh Rivas and Tyler Mitchell, and the centers will be Adam Holtorf.
Right.
We know that. So start with that unit and just maybe start giving me some thoughts on that group as a whole, sir.
I would say that of those five, and it might not be a popular take, but I think it's going to become the popular take. I think Tyler Mitchell's probably what they view as their best offensive lineman headed into this season. At least he was throughout the spring. That is the sense I got. And if you look at the end of last year, that's probably what the case was. And then you look at it differently, you say, well, who's the most skilled or the most talented player? It's probably not Tyler Mitchell, even though he's the best one right now. That's probably Josh Rivas.
Yeah.
That's probably why he started a couple games last year and played in nearly every single one as a redshirt freshman. And I anticipate him being a full season of starting as a sophomore. And he'll probably, you know, contend with Scott France in terms of, you know, career starts once he is all said and done for him. Also someone he could kick out the right tackle on a pinch and that might be asked of him to do this year because the tackle depth isn't what they wanted. And we'll get into that more. It's probably not as doom and gloom as what it looked like, you know, not too long ago. I think they're making some strides there behind who we believe to be the starters, but that's the position that still needs to address, particularly on the recruiting trail. And I think Adam Holtorf is a pretty good rock to have at center. And I know He's not a starter, but I think they view him as someone that can. And their sixth man is Evan Curl, and he gives them probably a lot of positional flexibility, which is quite an asset to have when you're a little bit weak at some of the spots in terms of depth.
What K-State does have, you know, on this unit, like you've talked about, there is a lot of experience. PFF, Pro Football Focus, pulled up right now. Adam Holtorf played 818 snaps last year, more than anybody else on the team on either side of the ball. Scott France, 766. Tyler Mitchell, 676. You lose Abdul Beach, who played 616, but then his replacement, Josh Rivas, played 354. So while Rivas is not a returning starter, that's more snaps than you would typically see a backup. To put that in some perspective, how many snaps it was for Josh Rivas, when you go back past him to looking at backup lineman snaps, it goes all the way down to Nick Kaltmeyer at 65 snaps. Then you've got Evan Curl at 14. Ben Adler played 12. Bill Kudyk, who's no longer at the program, played 12. So there wasn't many guys who got on the field outside of those top six. So what I'm saying is, while Rivas is not a returning starter, his experience is similar-ish to that of a guy who has real starting experience.
Yeah, and we probably... and I fall into the same trap. We probably have it backwards. I think some of us feel like we know what to expect more from Nick Kaltmeyer than we do for Josh Rivas. And really, it should be the exact opposite.
Right.
We should have pretty good faith and confidence in what Josh Rivas is going to become. And I think we're into the trap because we saw him play very well against an uninspired UCLA team in one bowl game. We think Nick Kaltmeyer is just going to step in and contribute and be solid. And hopefully that's the case, but it couldn't be farther from the truth in that we know that to be the case, because we have, outside of snap the UCLA game, and I think you said 16 snaps last year.
He's 65.
65 snaps
still not
last year.
Appeared in four games.
Yeah, so, 65 snaps in four games. I mean, it's, you're playing one possession. Almost.
40 of those he ran block on. So of course they're all. So he only passed protected 25 times last year.
Yeah, which is equivalent of two possessions.
Yeah. Adam Holtorf did 377 times.
Yeah, so I think we know we think we know more about Nick Kaltmeyer than we actually do.
Right, and it's funny, I think, because we're going to speak out of both sides of our mouths, and I'll speak for you, and you tell me if I'm wrong. I think we both kind of like him. I think we look at him from a physical build perspective, some potential, and think he might be a good player. But I agree with what you said too. Myself put way too much stock probably in that Cactus Bowl game where he played really well. He was on ESPN's first all-bowl team, you know, that year. So he played really well. And we're not trying to diminish it because, I like him as a player and think he has potential. But you are fooling yourself some if you don't remind yourself that was a UCLA team that had like four coaches on staff, I believe, at that time. Chose against playing a starting quarterback in that bowl game. Was not inspired to be there. And Nick Kaltmeyer beat the living tar out of him and give him credit for that. But I agree. He's not as much of a sure thing as perhaps some people portray based off of that one game.
Yeah, it might work out. It might be great. He might be solid. He might do just fine. And it wouldn't surprise me if he did. I think, the point we're making is we really don't know as much about him as what we might think we do.
Right. Let's just not count chickens before we're hatched because he had a great Cactus Bowl.
Right.
I think we're getting that. So you mentioned the four seniors. Talked about Scott France going to be at left tackle. Adam Holtorf going to be at center, of course. All three of these guys, if you're going to nerd out on grades, were better pass blockers last year than run blockers. All three graded at least an 82 or higher in Pro Football Focus. I know it's kind of an obscure number I picked, but it's one they all exceeded. Dalton Reisner did too. This is all in pass protection. No Big 12 team has more than one player returning on the offensive line to grade at least an 82 as a starter last year in pass protecting. K-State has three. So K-State's got an experienced line that showed some ability to pass protect. The problem is all three of them put up pretty poor run block numbers, and I think that's what K-State's going to focus more this year than passing the football.
Yeah, that would be a concern because this is a team that wants to run the ball a majority of the time, probably about 70. I think that they envision, and I know some of it is being ahead, but probably running the ball over 60% of the time, and that's a lot of snaps to do that when you might have an offensive line, at least from those numbers that would indicate that they're better as a pass blocking unit. Now that this year is just going to be, I won't say complete chaos, but in terms of what we've come to know, it's probably going to get flipped on its head a little bit because we're kind of leaning on numbers from a run blocking scheme that's going to look far different. Schematically, I think the biggest difference offensively is that their blocking schemes aren't going to look very similar at all. I think there's a very
Right.
A very stark contrast to the blocking scheme implemented by Connor Riley than the one that was implemented by Charlie Dickey.
Right. And that may show us some example of a guy, whether, you know, all these guys, to be fair, and PFF, I'll say this every time, take it with a grain of salt. I mean, like, it's opinion to an extent. Mm-hmm. Well, that's obviously completely opinion. So you can't just take these numbers and say they're gospel and exactly right. But yeah, K-State didn't have a single lineman or player, period, grade higher than a 70 in run blocking last year, except Dalton Risner, who's at an 85. So, yeah. But my point that Derek was making, and I want to agree with, is those numbers may prove to be not applicable in a different system. They were trying to run block in a completely different way. So just because they struggled to do it, you know, in a zone blocking scheme or what they were doing the year before, doesn't have to mean it's going to be the exact same group this year when they're more experienced and playing in an offense that's more conducive to attacking defensive lines and running the football.
Yeah, they'll probably have more of the numbers on their side when they do run it, even though they're not running with the quarterback. And you have to wonder, at least – I mean, I would like to talk to an offensive line coach or an offensive lineman that's played the position for quite a while, but I imagine that it's probably a little bit more simpler for an offensive lineman in a gap scheme relative to a zone scheme.
Right. I would think so, too. You mentioned Evan Curl. You know, he's the fifth scholarship senior on this thing. He's not going to start, but virtually any scenario, right, of a guy going down, and again, this could change. You know, we're talking about this in late July for an early August podcast, but at the moment, we're pretty much under the impression if somebody went down, whether it was center, guard, tackle, Evan Curl's probably coming in one way or another. He just may not play the spot that the player departed.
Yeah, I think that's exactly it. I think he's the sixth man, so to speak. And it just depends on, and I think some of that could be in flux, and it depends how things shake out during fall camp, of course. But if they're, you know, insistent on getting the five best on the field in some way, I think that would incorporate Evan Curl in some kind of fashion. If someone were to go down, and most likely he'd be the center, and then they'd shuffle bodies along to fit in the best five. But at the same time, yeah, there's still time. I think there's a couple guys like Christian Duffy and Ben Adler that maybe are close enough to being in the best five to where it might be simpler to just insert them into their positions, with Duffy being a tackle and Adler being a guard. But I think heading into camp, I think they probably lean on the side of Evan Curl is going to get on the field, whether it be at center, and if a guard goes down, but, you know, move Holtorf to guard and kick Rivas out to right, you know, right tackle. Yeah. There's some positional flexibility within those five, but I think right now, if someone were to go down, they'd like to lean on the side of inserting Evan Curl into the game rather than anyone else.
Fans oftentimes want to just look at it as simple as, okay, you know the starters, who are the twos? You just explained really well how they would actually sub. You know, K-State's going to have a depth chart that shows a backup at left tackle, a backup at left guard, a backup at center, a backup at right guard, a backup at right tackle. Those aren't going to be the guys who come into the game necessarily for an injury at that position. In fact, they probably won't. But as a fun exercise, let's talk through, if we were forced to make a second string offensive line, the tackles, would you go from what you've learned, would you say Katori Levinston and Christian Duffy,
yes,
even over Justin Eichmann, which I think I would, but is that probably what you'd guess?
Yep.
So let's say Levinston and Duffy at the tackles, Evan Curl probably reserve center if you were going with a completely different backup line. And then would you say the guards, what, Ben Adler?
Mm-hmm.
And then do you go Harrison Creed, Taylor Poitier, Cooper Beebe? Who, if I'm, you know, gun to your head, who's your other backup guards, you think?
Probably the true freshman Taylor Poitier or Noah Johnson, walk-on.
That's possible, too. So, I mean, you can. Again, we could sit here and build you out a second-team offensive line. In case they will show on the depth chart at some point, too. But, you know, I think that can mislead a person. And I'm just going to say a name. We've heard great things about Taylor Poitier. I know we have, and we'll talk about him in a second. But just because you see him, if he shows up as the backup left guard on the roster, does not mean if the left guard went down, Taylor Poitier would go in and replace him. Justin Eichmann, we mentioned briefly. He's a junior, a kid who had the opportunity, you know, to take a redshirt. K-State's got him and still is a junior on the roster. So that is what it is. A lot of height, a lot of length, that kind of stuff. A guy who was going to get, I think, a good Rivals ranking if he had stuck around at Butler and get some more interest. So it's not a kid that K-State took that just didn't deserve the offer, and he may still play a factor. But right now at this point, he would not be probably on those first two line of offensive linemen.
Yeah, and there's, you know, a little bit of chatter that the light might be finally starting to flicker on for him. But I think the top thing that held him back, even though it looks like he's starting to correct it, is just that he just didn't figure out in time what it took to be a player at this level. And some people don't. It takes
right.
It's playing at this kind of level of college football is tough to do, and it takes a lot of dedication, a lot of work, and some either don't want to do it or don't realize how much work it actually takes. And I think he's beginning to figure that out. The question is whether or not it's a little too late.
We've mentioned all the sophomores. I'll read them off again. Bit Adler, Harrison Creed, Josh Rivas. We talked a lot about Josh Rivas. The other two DY, is it fair to say from kind of what you hear and what we hear that Bit Adler is much closer to playing than I would say Harrison Creed is at this point?
Yeah, and not to write anyone off. With this current trajectory, I'd be surprised if Harrison Creed ever broke any kind of starting lineup while he is in Manhattan. I think he's kind of behind the eight ball in that regard. Mm-hmm. And on the other hand, I'd be shocked if Bit Adler's not a starter, you know, in 2020.
Right.
And he'll get, you know, probably some quality snaps in 2019 when the game isn't necessarily, you know, still up for grabs. There's still going to be those kinds of snaps, whether it's Kansas State on the upper side against, you know, Bowling Green or Nichols, or, you know, hopefully not, but unfortunately, if they're on the downside against some of the better teams on the schedule, either way, some of those, well, you know, you call them slop snaps or whatever you want. I think Bit Adler is going to get a good amount of them, and it's going to be a little bit of a trial for him because they're going to expect him to be a starter
right
a year from now.
Feel exactly the same. Redshirt freshman, we've mentioned both, but they're really worth talking about. I mean, we talk a lot, and you've done a great job of educating me and educating everyone on KSO about, you know, the tackle position and the future there. But now, as it stands, Katori Leviston, Christian Duffy, it looks like at least you've got two tackles who are redshirt freshmen who can grow in your program that perhaps can be bookends for this offense for some time going forward.
Yeah, I wonder if they're still not exactly the type of offensive tackles they want their
right
program to be built on, but I think that they believe that those two can play offensive tackle in this system. You know, recently just discovered or had it told to me that, you know, Katori Leviston does actually have the longest arms on his team.
Who we thought of being more guard than Duffy out of
right
the two. Yeah.
So that would suggest that they're getting closer to what they want there. And Duffy is a guy that they already had an offensive tackle back to when we were watching practice and the spring showcase during spring football. So I think those are two guys that they think that are definitely able to play off of the tackle. In a perfect scenario, I wonder if they would rather have them at guards. I don't know that. I think they are coming around on the idea that those two are definitely capable of playing on the outside.
All we've got left are the three true freshmen. We'll talk about each of them. I want to start with Trevor Stang because, as you kind of taught us earlier in this pod, we all know the starting center is Adam Holtorf. We all know their ideal backup center is Evan Curl, you know, that kind of thing. So they need another one, you know, for the future because their two are seniors. Out of the players on the roster right now, do you think Trevor Stang is somebody they're going to work maybe the most at center this year?
Yeah.
Aside from, of course, the guys who are ahead of him on the depth chart?
Yeah, he's probably the third center after Holtorf and Curl, unless, you know, obviously if they had to go to a third center, they probably wouldn't go to Trevor Stang this year. But
sure,
for the purpose of this conversation, yeah, I think Stang is the someone that they're looking to be a center in the future in a prominent one.
He's got to add a little bit of size.
Right.
Cooper Beebe needed to lose some. He came in at 6'3", like 342, and I think you told me he's dropped a little bit of weight and had a good camp. So camp's the wrong word. You know, a good offseason, summer so far, and working at guard on the offensive line.
Yeah, he's someone I've been told, one of the freshmen that has really been received very well by the upperclassmen. I think he's the upperclassmen, you know, they are always quick to embrace or receive the underclassmen, so to speak. They kind of got to prove themselves to the upperclassmen to be, you know, kind of be considered what they are. And I think Cooper Beebe is one of the few so far that has really thoroughly impressed the upperclassmen enough from someone that they've kind of embraced and accepted more than others at this point. So, and part of the reason is because he came in and has put in the work and the necessary amount of work that it takes to be successful at this level. And I think that's what they took notice of. BB's already lost, I think, at least 20 pounds.
Yeah, and that's the kind of stuff that's going to endear you, you know, to the coaching staff and your teammates, like you said, really quickly. You know, Taylor Podier, I always think I'm saying his name wrong. Do you pronounce the R? How do you say it?
No, I pronounce the first I. It's Poitier.
Okay, Poitier, like that, not mm-hmm. Poitier. I'm going to say Poitier. Mm-hmm. And then somebody at a presser are going to say it's Jara. Get it? Because Cartier Jara joke. Yeah, so anywho, he's in the middle of those two in the sense that Stang still needs to add some weight. BB needs to lose some and already has made progress. Poitier, there we go, got it. Came in listed at just like 255, not real big. I think the current roster is at 275. You've heard he's up to maybe even 285. Mm-hmm. And talk about a guy who probably didn't get a lot of hype, at least from us in the recruiting class, that if you just, you know, were to ignore all that and listen to what coaches are telling us, maybe, you know, here and there about guys, or people are telling us here and there about guys, it sounds pretty positive on him.
Yeah, he's one of the three offensive linemen that they've added. He's the one that looks the most like the part that you would hope to see from an offensive lineman at Kansas State. And I think some of the height and weights, I don't know how accurate at times. I think sure. He arrived at 270, 280. I don't know how long he's been at 270, 280, but I think he arrived there in June at that weight. So I don't think that he's necessarily put on 20 to 30 pounds summer. I just don't think we had it.
Let's just give him credit for it, okay? Come on.
Sometimes I just don't think some of those were up to date as much as they should have been. But in terms of outside of just looking the part, I think he's also probably the most athletic of the three. Now, obviously, BB was a little over and Stang was a little under, so it might be easy to do that. But I think that even the coaching staff are kind of surprised at the kind of athlete that they've landed in him.
As a whole, we've been critical at times on the site and in the series of some of the scholarship allotments at particular positions. I wouldn't really be at this one. You know, they've got 14 on scholarship. I know Chris Kleiman said multiple times at Big 12 Media Days they were happy with just the overall numbers at offensive line. So it makes me think they want to hang around 14, 15, perhaps. The problem, DY, is we've talked about this. Five of those are seniors, you mm-hmm. know. You're starting, and two of those are your starting tackles. So you lose five. You got to think you're probably signing at least five, if not six, to put you up to 15. They've got three commitments right now. Sam Shields, Hadley Panzer, Carver Willis. Let's start with Carver Willis because they're going to need to sign two or three tackles in some manner, and he's the only one in the class so far.
Yeah, I would think that outside of Carver Willis, they'll definitely add at least one more high school offensive tackle that's probably, you know, built and shaped in a similar way that Willis is, and I think they will add at least one junior college offensive tackle, at least one that they – view as a plug-and-play type that can come in and start for them next year. At least that is best-case scenario. Sometimes you're not able to have best-case scenario, but that's what we're talking about here. Best-case scenario is they find a plug-and-play junior college offensive tackle during the fall that will arrive in January, go through spring football, and then starts next fall. That's what they want. They take two if two present themselves. That'll be tough to do, but they wouldn't turn down a second one. So I do say you got three offensive linemen now. I think they'll add three more, whether that's two high school and one JUCO or two JUCOs and one high school. I think that's how it will finish. And I think that he'll probably be defensive tackle, but there's still a little bit of a chance where Taylor Warner plays on offensive line as well.
We got to see all three of these commits when you think about it. You watch Carver Willis at camp. We watched Hadley Panzer. We've seen Sam Shields both in person and at camp. Let's move to Panzer because we talked in center earlier, you know, in the center of the future, because again, your top two centers, it's scary-ish when your top two centers on the roster are seniors and your top two tackles are seniors. Hadley Panzer's a guy, after watching how physical he was in camp and just his style of play, that I know you think potentially has a chance to end up at that position down the road for K-State.
Yeah, I think he's a perfect center as well. Very physical, kind of a bulldog mentality, and a state champion wrestler as well. So I think a lot of what he does well translates to the center position, and he just kind of has that low to the ground, wide body shape that, you know, and while understanding leverage, I like what his potential could be, you know, at the apex of the offensive line, and one that, you know, I think I've heard the offensive coaching staff kind of views him as a possible center moving forward as well.
Last but not least would be Manhattan native Sam Shields, with the first of these three linemen to commit, if I remember correctly. It was, yeah. Now, Sam Shields, a guy, you're going to look at his profile, say 6'5", 287. Why can't he play guard? I've told this story a couple times, but I always chuckle at it. When I spoke to Sam Shields for a little video for our site in Salina, and one of the first things he said to me was, like, I don't have long enough arms to play tackle. And I almost jokingly wanted to say to him, did DY tell you that? Because DY has taught us that, hey, just because you're 6'5", doesn't mean you have long arms to play tackle. Sam Shields, example of that, a three-star kid, a good get for K-State, but he's probably going to play inside. Like Panzer, maybe more likely a guard, though.
Yeah, I think he's a guard, and he probably isn't the athlete enough to play on the edge either. I think he's a pretty good athlete, but more of a north-south type of way, and not just a, you know, a lot of raw athleticism. So someone that can definitely be a pretty good pulling guard. It's eventually, you know, at Kansas State, which I think they'll do on from occasion. I think they did that at North Dakota State with their, you know, different schemes and setups. So I think he can be used in that way. But in terms of being on the edge, probably not in his future. But I think he's a guard. And of the three, despite Willis kind of not being physically advanced enough, I think Shields actually might be the farthest away from contributing at this point.
Yeah, there's some body work to do, of course, like most freshmen coming in, you know, to big-time college football. That's going to wrap up our offensive line podcast. I think Derek drove from Kansas City today to do this with me, so I really appreciate that. I think Flando for putting this together. Always got to say I appreciate the Tallgrass Tap House, Bourbon and Baker, and Harry's for the support they've given us now for over a year. That's crazy when you think about that, so I appreciate that. We'll come back on this coming Saturday, and we will talk defensive line as we finally get to the defensive side of the ball. Until then, please keep checking in to KSO Online and help us grow our business by
telling your friends.